Now, joining us, we have another stalwart of a speaker who's often been called a disruptor, either by the industry or by the competitors as well. But most importantly, we have with us Mr. Patanjali Keswani, who's fondly known as Patu Keswani, who's the chairman and managing director of Lemon Tree Hotels. And we all know that he's a man behind the growth and the success of the Lemon Tree Hotels Limited. And it's only befitting that we now get insights as to how can we pave way for the future. So let's find out more about this. Let's get some nuggets of interesting perspectives from our keynote speaker, Mr. Patu Keswani. So good evening, Mr. Keswani. Firstly, thank you so much for joining us. And with that, I'm going to hand over the proceedings to you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, Kavya. Good afternoon, everybody. So I'll step out of the hotel space for a moment. And I'd just like to provide some context. So the first context is that, any crisis of this nature, which is global or even regional, it affects the ecosystem. By the ecosystem, I mean the entire economy, which is the sale of goods, services, information, data, what have you. And hotels are an integral part in the sense that they get customers from all parts of this value chain, okay, this interconnected economy. So we get business as, from B2C, we get B2B, we get B2B2C. So I think the big question we have to ask ourselves is, how will this pandemic affect the ecosystem? And through the ecosystem, how will it ultimately affect the hotel sector as a whole? So let me go back to the past, because I think people who don't learn from history are kind of doomed to repeat it. If you look at the history of pandemics, they've been prevalent throughout human history, or at least recorded human history. So what has been widely recorded has been the bubonic plague that has occurred multiple times in the last 2000 years. The biggest impact was in 1347, when it was called the Black Death, when it killed about 50 million people, when the population of the world must have been 500 million or less. So you have a situation where, these pandemics have repeatedly come in history, and there have been repeated standard outcomes at the end of those pandemics. So let me talk about the most recent. In the 20th century, there were three major pandemics. The first was, and all were influenza-based. The first was the Spanish flu. It occurred in 1918, and the world population was then 1.5 billion people. The Spanish flu infected one-third, 500 million, killed 10% of them, which is 50 million. In fact, I believe in India alone, about 10 to 12 million people died. This was followed 40 years later, 40 years later by the Asian flu. And this Asian flu killed about 1 million people. 10 years later, in 1968, there was the Hong Kong flu, and that killed about 2 million people. So it is not that we haven't had these massive global or very large regional outbreaks. We've had them. And it is very interesting, if you look at it, that in all cases, firstly, they originated from Asia. The Black Death originated, in fact, from Mongolia. The Spanish flu and so on from other parts of Asia. But the broad point I'm trying to make is that within 3 years, in all cases, humanity went back to normal. Okay, so there was utter crisis, utter fear, change in human behavior. By the way, in the Spanish flu and the next two flus, everybody used to wear masks and practice social distancing. But basic human nature reverted to normal within 3 years. And the reason that occurred was that there was no cure found for this flu, everybody got herd immunity, right? So let's now bring it to current context, which is this COVID-19 virus. The fact of the matter is that, unlike in the past, two big differences are there with this flu, this virus. The first is that today is a time of global communication, instant global communication. So the knowledge about this, or the lack of knowledge, or the misinformation that we're getting, never before in history has a disease been so quickly communicated to the whole world. Second is, never before in history has any disease got the kind of global attention it has today in terms of government, laboratories, pharma companies. They are all focused on finding a vaccine or a cure. Now, this disease obviously is highly infectious. And the fear today in the current scenario is that people think that A, they can get it very easily, which is true, and that mortality rate, the death rate, is very high. Actually, it is not so high, because what we know are the number of people who've died. What we don't know is what is the denominator, what is the base, what are the number of people who have it. So those of you who are interested can look at the Yale Medical School. They did a study in the US, and they say the actual mortality rate based on actual expected numbers of infection is about 0.37 to 0.55%. It is not 3 to 4% as being reported, because there are many, many more people who are infected who don't even know they are infected. So with this backdrop, what am I talking about? What I'm really trying to say is that there is instant fear. There is a lot of attention. There's panic today. Okay, and that has led to lockdowns, to people being, you know, changing behavior, not wanting to go out, and so on. So fundamentally, this is a global health crisis, which has in turn impacted the economy and led to a global financial / economic crisis. Obviously, since hotels are right at the front of the discretionary consumption sector, we have been worst affected. So tourism, with hotels, aviation, including retail now, are utterly affected. And what this has meant is there has been total demand destruction. In April, for example, I was told by HTL that out of 160,000 branded rooms in India, 60,000 were operating. That means 60% of the supply had shut down. Similarly, of the demand in February of about 115,000 to 120,000 rooms, by April, this demand had dropped to 15,000, which is an 85% demand destruction. So the way I see this play out is, now there are three segments which consist broadly of demand in the hotel space. One is domestic individuals. Second is international travelers. And third is large blocks, bulk, what we call MICE. So the way I see it playing out is, today, this enormous supply destruction is going to severely affect those hotels especially. While it will affect all hotels equally, it will affect those hotels that have high leverage and very high fixed costs most significantly. So what I expect will happen is that based on what little information I have from the medical fraternity, is that in the next 6 to 9 months, there will be some form of cure for this virus, okay, which will drop the mortality rate close to zero. So fear of death will disappear, and this fear of death will lead to the revival of domestic travel. So if I made a wild projection, I would say next 4 months, India is going to have an explosion of infections. And along the same time, after 4 to 6 to 8 months, there will be a cure. And once there is a cure and fear of death goes, there will be the resumption of domestic travel gradually, but it will start. This will be followed, hopefully, by a vaccine in the next 18 to 24 months. But if there is no vaccine, then let's learn from history. There will be herd immunity. And once herd immunity occurs, what is herd immunity? It simply means that once 60, 70% of the population have this disease, then the virus doesn't transmit easily. So normally, if you take a room of 10 people and one person who's infected goes into that room, he or she will infect 5 to 6 people. But if there are those 10 people, 6 or 7 already have had the disease and have herd immunity, then the infection rate drops dramatically, and that person may or may not infect one person, you know, other than themselves. So herd immunity or a vaccine will lead to the resumption of the second two segments, which is international travel and MICE. So forward projection, next 6 to 9 months, resumption of domestic travel. Next 18 to 24 months, resumption of international and MICE business. In the meantime, what is going to happen is, and this is my big fear, not only for hotels, but for the economy in general, is that this short-term demand destruction, which will revive, which will come back at most in 2-2.5 years, will lead to long supply destruction. What will happen is under capitalized or under equitized players, those who have high debt, who don't have liquidity available, will go under. And those hotels, and in fact, broader parts of the economy will never revive. Or revive many, many, many years later. So from a positive perspective, I reckon that up to 2-3 years, while demand will jump to normal, supply will pretend that the loss of supply in the hotel space. So what do we do about it? What are the short-term measures, at least, for example, what Lemon Tree did, and I'm sure most other people have done, is first is, how do you create an opportunity out of this? So I think what it's forced us to do is look at all our costs. We reviewed our costs. We thought we were efficient and cost-effective players, but we realized that was not quite so. What we have learned is that our staffing ratios, although we thought, you know, at one person per room was not high, we've discovered we can actually make do with 0.7. So it's 30% large numbers of productivity improvement and hiring freeze for a long time so that we can come down to the new numbers. So my view is that we should use this opportunity to mass reduce our costs without cutting muscle, because I find in some cases, you know, you cut muscle, it will ultimately affect your recovery in the long term. And then use those new cost ratios once things normalize for a significant expansion in your EBITDA margins. So that's one. The second thing is, of course, create liquidity, find a way to have enough cash available to you that you can service your debt. I don't think we can depend indefinitely on the RBI giving a moratorium on, you know, on debt. One should definitely plan to have enough money available from September onwards. The third I would very strongly recommend is do not lay off employees. I have noted that I am starting to read of increasing cases of job losses. In fact, there is an estimate that 25% of jobs in India, about 120 million people, are jobless today. Now, this will have multiple impacts. When you lay off employees, one is the economic impact on the economy as a whole. One is the social impact, which is you are taking people who are the most powerless. Normally, you lay off very junior people, and those who need the money most are, at a time when they need it today, are deprived of it. So it's a cruel decision to take. Third is, let's talk as businessmen. Why should we lose highly trained people when there are other ways to save money? I mean, one simple way, like what Lemon Tree did, is it insisted on a 50% minimum salary cut for the leaders. And that effectively translated to a 20% saving in our wage bill. So I would say, if you must put pain across the table, then put it at the top level, which can, you know, which has opportunities, which has savings, rather than at the entry associate level. And when demand bounces back, these very same employees will give you that service that will make you highly successful. So it's actually a smart business decision. Next is, I would say, pay your small vendors. I find, from what I've understood, a lot of people are not making payments. Well, that's totally understandable from a cash flow perspective. Please pay the small vendors, the MSMEs, because that is the part of the ecosystem that will be most damaged. And when I talked in the beginning about the ecosystem, I said specifically that we should worry about the entire economy, the entire value chain, rather than just the hotel sector, because ultimately we get business. These are our vendors and our consumers. And of course, last is, reach out to your customers to the maximum extent possible. I'm sure all of you have databases. Reach out, reassure, tell them what you're doing with, you know, the new norms, which all of us, I have no doubt, have put in place. And once you do that, just ride this storm. And I have no doubt those who survive will bounce back much, much stronger in the next 2-3 years. Thank you. Kavya, I'm over with.
Pardon, sir? Am I audible, sir? Is it all audible right now? Audible. Yes. I Yes, sir. So I wanted to firstly thank you because one, the fact that you spoke about how it's not just about the ecosystem, but how it's affecting the economy, to see the bigger picture out there. And also the interesting initiatives that Lemon Tree has taken. That is something that you've shared with all of us, in fact, with all of the attendees as well. I think one thing, really, I guess, while we're not really taking questions, I just wanted to ask one last thing about the fact that that there can always be a new opportunity that people can look forward to, the kind of scenario that we are in right now. You think that is something really strong that we can look forward to, a learning that we can look forward to and change the dynamics of the industry?
So I noticed the industry, Kavya, is talking a lot about the new norms of social distancing, of, you know, X, Y, Z. And I personally, and this may be, you know, contrary to popular view, I believe, I'm convinced that in 2 to 3 years, all this business about social distancing, masks, hygiene, etc., will go out of the window. As I said, those who don't learn from history are doomed to repeat it, right? In every single instance, people have reverted to norm. It is human behavior. We are social creatures. So sure, right now, I totally agree, put in place most stringent possible hygiene protocols. But it's not permanent. Okay. What is permanent is your employees, your customers, the business, and you should take steps to ensure that you learn from this, especially the efficiencies you put in place, and just make it part of your business once things normalize.
Thank you so much again, Mr. Casey, for joining us today. Thank you once again for sharing your experience and learnings with all of us and with all of our attendees. After the very interesting, befitting keynote for all of you.